I am a pathologist, as you can infer from the title of my presentation, and it's my huge pleasure to be here today to discuss how a pathologist looks at gastric cancer. And despite the developments of molecular pathology, I think that we pathologists, we still have a role that is very important, and I'll try to bring my views to you. So to begin with, we should be aware that in gastric cancer, we have mainly sporadic gastric cancer constituting something like 90% of the cases, and you have hereditary. I'll address this very briefly at the end. And for sporadic gastric cancer, we should be aware of histopathology and molecular pathology and hereditary cancers. Genetic susceptibility is the most important. Of course, you should be careful about the precursor lesions, which is really important, but we do not have time to address this issue today. So the first issue that has been addressed already in the previous presentation regarding gastric cancer, it's heterogeneity. And this heterogeneity is revealed at the macroscopic level. We have polypoid, fungating, ulcerated, infiltrative lesions, and this is the drawing of the so-called Bormann classification of gastric cancer. And this heterogeneity is reflected also in the histology. And you have different types of gastric cancer at the microscope. You have tubular, papillary, the so-called signet ring, the mucinous, and you have something that you should be aware of, and is the example of heterogeneity, which are the mixed carcinomas, and in the same tumor, you can get a glandular component together with a poorly cohesive component. We do not have the time to go in detail in discussing all the reasons behind the careful research about the different types of gastric cancer, but I want to bring to you, which is the last edition of WHO classification, published in 2010, and is the one that is used currently all over the world, in which these two entities were highlighted, and I bring them in red, which are the poorly cohesive carcinoma and the mixed carcinoma. For those of you who have been here since the beginning of this session, the first author clearly discussed this issue when you have to discuss diffuse type of gastric cancer, namely in clinical trials. You should be aware that the diffuse cancer is something that has to be strictly defined. And according to WHO, this diffuse type is now designated as poorly cohesive. And within, you have the pure signet ring cell cancer, and you have other variants that can have a different biology, and this has been shown by different studies. So this is really relevant. That's why I highlight in red this aspect. But if you come to the basic classification, most of the epidemiological studies are using, you get the so-called intestinal type of gastric cancer that in WHO corresponds to tubular or papillary, and you get a diffuse that in WHO currently should be designated as poorly cohesive or signet ring according to the cases. And these different types of gastric cancer, they have a different biology, they have a different epidemiology, and they have a different molecular pathology. And this is the basic. I think this is what everybody knows. Every oncologist in this room, I'm absolutely sure, knows about this. And though this is known already from a couple of years, is what is really stable and used in practice for therapeutic proposals. So if you come to the so-called intestinal type of cancer, what we have the major features concern HER2 alterations and microsatellite instability, and this is getting a hot issue. And if you come to the poorly cohesive type of gastric cancer, you have the changes in E-cadherin. This is the basis of the basis. We'll bring some complexity to the field. Beginning by microsatellite instability, I'm sure all of you are aware of what microsatellite instability is. In gastric cancer, is a biomarker of good prognosis. In gastric cancer, sporadic type, it is caused by the methylation of MLH1 gene. And it was demonstrated that the patients carrying tumors with microsatellite instability, they do better regarding survival than those in which the tumors are stable. And this is reflected in multivariate analysis in some studies that has been shown as an independent prognostic factor. But the issue is getting more and more interesting these days, not only because of this information on the prognosis of the disease, but also because of the putative impact for therapy. So what are we pathologists asked to do today for you oncologists? We are asked to identify microsatellite instability, which you do currently by the detection of mismatch repair deficiency. What do I mean by this? We study by immunohistochemistry the expression of the proteins encoded by the different genes of the mismatch repair system. The letters are very small, but I can read for you. This is MLH1, this is PMS2, this is MSH2, and this is MSH6. What you can see here is that we have the retention of the expression in MSH2 and MSH6 that is lost for MLH1 and PMS2. This means in this specific tumor, there is a deficient in the mismatch repair system. And you have to get used to this terminology because it's coming every day, and you should ask your pathologist to provide this information. And this is very relevant. Is this enough, would you ask? Or would you need something else? In some centers, in every case, the clinicians request also the study of microsatellite instability by molecular means, and this can be done by multiplex PCR. It's not a practice in our center. You just perform the search of mismatch repair deficiency by immunohistochemistry, but you should be aware this can be done by multiplex PCR, and it is expected that in the future this will move to something that is next-generation sequencing, NGS, for the detection of microsatellite instability. I think it's not a practice yet, but will come. Why is this relevant? Because we can get much information for this new approach. Because you can come to the identification of instability signatures. It is well known that different types of cancers, they have different types of signatures of microsatellite instability. And on the top, it is also known that microsatellite instability is not something of yes and no. It's something in which you have a gradient, so you have a spectrum, it's a continuous variable. So then there is a demonstration that there is a relationship between the burden of microsatellite instability and the overall survival of the patients. So not yet in use, but it will come, I'm sure. And not to mention that it is in the background of these type of tumors that you can get the overexpression of PD-L1 with the consequences for immunotherapy. If you move now to HER2, HER2 is well known in gastric cancer in about something is variable, something between 10-20%. It's very variable in the literature. Also, the impact in prognosis is also variable. There is no agreement. It depends on the experience. In our hands, in our group, we have demonstrated that amplification of HER2 demonstrated by FISH analysis is connected to a poor prognosis and to hematogenous metastasis involving the liver. We are not going to discuss for oncologists the discovery of the effect of this drug in the benefits for gastric cancer treatment, which is not comparable to the breast in the stomach, but anyway, it's in use. But we have to be aware, and we come back to the issue of heterogeneity, that for HER2 expression, it is extremely heterogeneous in the stomach. And this is the same case in which you can have areas in which you have high expression with the demonstration of amplification, in others in which you have a moderate expression, and still in the same tumor, completely negative areas. So you can infer from here the impact you may have. If you wanted to know about HER2 alteration in biopsies, you can get preoperatively. And this is something that is also to be taken in consideration. This is a study performed by an Italian group in which was clearly demonstrated that different biopsies along the surface of the tumor would give different results. And these authors came to the suggestion that you should be aware of and take in consideration that at least 5 biopsies should be taken if you wanted to get any information regarding HER2 amplification for therapeutic purposes. And it is under debate these days, and we have done that, the possibility of retesting in the case of the negative biopsies, but that is still under analysis. And now you have to come to what is the input from the high throughput technologies in gastric cancer. And I'm beginning, I'll do it very briefly, and I'm beginning with the studies coming from Singapore. You'll have the pleasure to have the next speaker will be Patrick Tan, maybe the guy with the highest expertise in gastric cancer regarding molecular pathology and molecular features. So I think it's really very good to have him here today. And I'm bringing the results from his group. And this is published in 2012. And what they have shown at this time, which is already a long time ago, we are in 2017, many other things were discovered, but it was discovered that besides HER2, there are amplifications in other oncogenes in gastric cancer. And these oncogenes encode for receptors of tyrosine kinases, and these genes, they are amplified in something that is a mutually exclusive. So either you get HER2 amplification or c-MET amplification, you don't get both. This is not completely true these days because increasing the series of cases, it was demonstrated more recently that you can get amplification of more than one of these genes with implications for therapy. I like very much this study coming also from the Singapore group. Now we are talking about the expression study, and in this study it was identified three types of gastric cancer regarding the phenotype by morphology and the molecular features. These types were mesenchymal, proliferative, and metabolic. We won't spend much time discussing this, but it's important to import this to the new classifications. So the mesenchymal corresponds to the so-called diffuse, in which you have hypermethylation and low copy number alterations, and this is where you get the alterations in adhesion, in ecadherin, and so on and so forth. The proliferative can correspond mostly to the chromosomal instability, and metabolic, you should be aware, because this is becoming very important, not only in the stomach, but also in the segments of the digestive system. I guess Patrick may approach this also, and is becoming really relevant. And I like this very much, this group, because in this metabolic thing, you have alterations in genes that are normally expressed in gastric mucosa, and apparently there is a specific sensitivity to 5-FU, and there is gastric differentiation, which is a topic I really like, but we do not have time to address this day. And we come to the landmark classification of gastric cancer. Everybody knows about it. I think that you cannot go to any congress, you don't see this slide, which comes from the TCGH classification, in which you have the groups you already knew. You already knew there are chromosomal instability in gastric cancer. We know that for many years now. We already knew there is microsatellite instability in gastric cancer, so this is only the consolidation of the knowledge we had before. And you knew before that it is genomic stable gastric cancer, corresponds to the diffuse type with the features I have briefly addressed. And it is highlighted something we knew already, but now gets an importance because of the impact in therapy putatively, which are the gastric cancer related to Epstein-Barr virus expression, and I'll describe briefly. This type of gastric cancer has a specific phenotype with a huge infiltration with lymphocytes, and I want to highlight the lymphocytes. They are getting very important. Soon afterwards, it was 1 year later, there is this classification coming from the Asian Cancer Research Group. You are aware, it's quite similar. What is the major difference? EBV-related gastric cancer are not highlighted as a separate group here, and those that are microsatellite stable are divided according to the alterations in P53 because this has an impact in the prognosis. So this classification shows some relevance because of the impact in prognosis. And in some of the analysis, the cases of this study were put together from the Singapore group and the TCGH. And also because there is some relationship with the pattern of recurrence. And for instance, if you look at the cases that are microsatellite stable, and you can see that these cases, it is related and with the epithelial mesenchymal transition corresponding to the diffuse type, there is a recurrence that is particularly important in this type of patients, and also the peritoneal seeding that is also characteristic of this type, and the others that correspond more to the intestinal phenotype, they have a different metastatic pathways through the blood vessels to the liver. So there is this information that actually we knew already, but now is integrated in a more comprehensive way. But the problem is, can we bring this for your everyday life? Are you going to ask us just to perform high throughput technology in every case to bring you this information? I'm afraid you are not, but you can ask us some other type of things, because we pathologists, we play a pivotal role in your life, and we can provide you a lot of information using basic medical technology. And you can use immunohistochemistry, and you can use in situ hybridization. And with these two methodologies, you can provide you information about EBV infection. Yes, we can. Can we provide about microsatellite instability? Yes, we can. Can we provide about the microsatellite stable epithelium mesenchymal? Yes, we can, by the search of phenotype and decadrin. Can we study the expression of P53? Yes, we can. So we have in our hands a lot of tools that can give you a first hint that can constitute an orientation for your decisions regarding therapy. This study I'm showing you comes from a Western population, but recently it was published a similar study from Eastern population with exactly the same results. We cannot go in depth, but summarizing what can be done in our hands is to use the molecular classification of gastric cancer by immunohistochemical analysis and in situ hybridization. And this can be used in the clinical setting in the foreseeable future, we think. You are not going in detail in all these features, and I want to highlight at this stage only some of the alterations that these groups of cancers can express. And this one, for instance, with aberrant expression of P53, there are some genes that are altered, such as GATA6, GATA5, and this may have an impact. We don't know yet. But let me show you some of the features of the EBV-related gastric cancer. The morphology is very typical. There is a huge infiltration of lymphocytes. So then this is very typical. In this morphological histotype, EBV infection is quite frequently affects younger patients, proximal stomach, expansive growth, Lorin classification is undeterminate, has a lower TNM stage, lesser venous invasion, better overall survival. And, very relevant, these cases with this phenotype, they are either EBV positive or microsatellite instability cases. They do not accumulate these two features. They are features that do not come together. So either you have EBV or you have microsatellite instability. Do we have anything in common? Yes, they have. Because in both of these types, you can have overexpression of PD-L1, so they are candidates in the future for immunotherapy. So what is new regarding this is the tumor microenvironment that is well characterized these days, and is also, as I mentioned, the expression of PD-L1, PD-1, and the putative use of this type of cancer for immunotherapy in the future, which is not validated yet. So what am I highlighting at the moment, not going to the details, is that in gastric cancer you have the epithelial cells themselves, but you cannot forget the tumor microenvironment. And you cannot forget the tumor microenvironment, because there is an impact of this feature of gastric cancer in the behavior of the tumors. And now you can classify this tumor microenvironment as high immunoscore or low, and it has been shown in some clinical trials, not yet transferred to clinics, that when you have a high immunoscore and you have chemotherapy given to the patients, those with a high immunoscore, they do better regarding disease-free survival and also overall survival. And this is not the case when the tumors have a low immunoscore. So it's not only the impact overall, but it's also the impact on the effects of the therapy, and this will come, I'm sure. And you have to be aware also that we have the tumor with the neoplastic cells and the microenvironment, but we have our microenvironment. And what we are interested in very recently is on the effect of this macro environment of the metabolic environment related to diabetes, obesity, and to study the features of gastric cancer in this setting, because it was shown that some of the alterations I've shown before can lead to an alteration of HNF4 alpha gene, and this is targetable. for antidiabetic treatment with metformin. So we don't know how much the gastric cancer developing in this setting can have a different behavior. Should be aware of that. And just very briefly, the hereditary cancer, just to remind you, there is something that you know very well, you are not going to repeat, which is hereditary diffuse gastric cancer. The macro features are very well known, as well as histological features. You have the major publications on this issue where you can review. And very importantly, you have the guidelines. I think that in these guidelines, you can find the answers to almost every question you may have regarding gastric cancer. And this is published in Journal of Medical Genetics in 2015. And what I want to highlight and to bring to your attention, and come back to the poorly cohesive carcinoma, you expect in a carrier of a mutation of E-cadherin gene that if you have the lesion in the stomach, which is gastric cancer, is signaturing cell type, which is the most frequent pure signaturing cell type. But you should be aware that even in the setting of hereditary gastric cancer, the poorly cohesive carcinoma can be very nasty looking. And this would lead the pathologist who is not aware of this, of designating this as undifferentiated carcinoma and putting the patient out of the screening for ECAD mutation. And this is something we should be aware of, because this exists. And I'm coming back to the issue of heterogeneity also in the setting of hereditary gastric cancer. This is currently a major issue of our research to know why some cases behave very indolently with signaturing cell phenotype, and in other cases you have an aggressive, nasty phenotype, and we have published this already. We think there is overexpression in aggressive cases of P53 with an increased proliferation index. And if you look at this, you will see how different gastric cancer can be, even in the setting of hereditary cases. And just very few words about this other syndrome that in the past I used to say it was a variant of hereditary gastric cancer, which is GAP syndrome, and we have to correct that. It's no longer a variant of hereditary gastric cancer. This why? Because this is something in which you have carpeting polyposis fundicline type and you have gastric cancer developing and killing the patients. All these genes were screened and were negative, but very recently, after a couple of years, it was possible to identify the genetic cause of this syndrome, which is a point mutation in exon 1B of APC gene that qualifies this syndrome, not a kind of hereditary diffuse gastric cancer, but a variant of familial adenomatous polyposis. So the summary of this is that if you have alterations in APC gene, if they are in the hot spot, you have the classic phenotype, you know very well. At extremities, you can have the attenuated phenotype. And you should be aware now that if the mutation occurs in the promoter region of the gene, you can have this phenotype of GAP syndrome that you should be aware of because it exists. And it was described in Australia, United States, and Japan. And it is now at least one case described in Europe. This comes from Czech Republic. In this case, it was extremely aggressive and killed two patients already. So summarizing, I think we are at the age of integrated molecular pathology, and we have to have the clinical phenotype. It's always the basis. Molecular pathology is nothing without the clinical phenotype. And you have molecular pathology with the spatial and temporal heterogeneity, and you should be aware of genomics, epigenomics, proteomics, because there's a huge distance between what the genome is and what the proteins are and effects are. And I think Patrick Tan will address this in a minute, which is, again, a pleasure. So we need all this for a better understanding and for translation to clinics. We need bridges. And thank you so much for your attention.